like things are finally coming around. I know we've got a long, long way to go. And where we'll end up, I don't know. But we won't let nothing hold us back. We're putting our shirts together. We're polishing up our act. If you've ever been held down before, I know you refuse to be held down anymore.
And stimulating change from a constant supply of relevant knowledge and information.
No more youths and youths for sale. We get wise and don't decide to change their style. Bobby Rock, keep your empty promises and your crooked smile. Metamorphosis, come with your thoughts, change your way of thinking. Metamorphosis, the change begins with you.
Man of Tarsus, black men of Ethiopia, Timbuktu, Alexandria, gave the light of civilization to this world. Ethiopia shall stretch forth our hands unto God, and princes shall come out of Egypt.
I and I, son of the Most High, Jah Rastafari.
Keep listening.
Will you hear me say no? Without any apology, it no good to stay in a white man country too long. It's no good to stay in a white man country too long. It's no good to stay in a white man country too long. In the 50s, my mother, sister,
Africa.
Greetings, metamorphosis, times continue to befuddle the African people. In the UK, mourning and grieving, England is in mourning and grieving. British society is mourning. They're mourning the loss of 96 English supporters who died in the latter part of the 1980s in a football stadium. I'm myself a footballer and a lover of sport, was a part of the audience that witnessed this on television and grieved with the families and the persons who left their homes to play or watch a football match and ended up dead. So 96 people were crushed in that stadium disturbance. And at this point in time, in 2016, the verdict has been declared, and it is now official that 96 white English football supporters were unlawfully killed, and the police are now being held responsible for the deaths of these persons. 96 persons. As an African looking on, I reflect on the hundreds and millions, hundreds of millions of black people who were legally killed, lawfully killed, with no compensation, no remorse. It has forced Ayman to question the existence of the powerful deities that are put in place to guide and protect. And ultimately, it leaves I to wonder, what is a white life? What is a white life? When blacks in America must begin to organize groups that are called Black Lives Matter, it forced Ayman now to ask the question, what the heck is a white life? What is a white life? Is a white life more valuable than a black life? Metamorphosis, exploring seriously just what it really means to be white. Messiah Garvey emphasized that the key to the reorganization and the upliftment of the African people was to rally around a principle, and that principle was described as race first. That seemed to be the hardest thing to sink into the brains of black people because of the religious education that tried to drive away the concept of race from our meditation. But race first is a significant philosophy and an ideological position to build a race of people when the individuals hold the philosophy in common. Now, in the state of Georgia, in the United States, and of course, hailing up to Sister Grace in that place. But in the state of Georgia, there was a massive white power rally. A massive white power rally. And what these people who gathered in their large numbers were declaring and protesting about. They were protesting against the concept of diversity. They had their large banners, and the most outstanding banner read, "Diversity equals white genocide." I wonder what them think about that equation, that diversity equals white genocide. This is the view of the Caucasian people in Georgia, the people who are considered to be white. The people in London who were victims at the football match, distance away across the continent. The similarity in the people there and the people in Georgia is that they all call themselves white. And on that basis, they have developed ideological positions that are similar. So I and I must spend a little bit of time truly examining, what does white mean? What is this to be white? What is whiteness? We have been overpowered with blackness and the fear of blackness and the darkness and the evil and what darkness is and evil, and we're overpowered with that. But what really is white? That black people have to be demanding that people become conscious that black lives matter. We have to be saying that. So what is it about a white life that they don't have to be walking around declaring that white lives matter? Something is amiss. And the metamorphosis in this ultimate delivery will attempt to explore what really is it that has overwhelmed us as black people, that we genuflect when anything white comes in front of us in terms of people, and we're always under imageries of white in domination. Well, what is it to be white? What is a white life? What is a white life? And is a white life more valuable? Is it more sacred than a black life? And what about the life of the Indian and the life of the Oriental? So we will not be locked into this black and white argument the way the Europeans like to have us. We're to look at it in a broader context. But fundamentally, we want to zero in on this idea of whiteness. What is it to be white? Why does a white life mean more than a black life? Why is it in the United States the police can randomly shoot black people? And the cry goes out again for understanding. Well, it goes deeper than understanding. We have to understand the nature now of the beast himself. In America, you used to call him the man. You have to get to understand the man. Well, we need to reflect again and begin to study about the beast. Who is this beast that when he cries out, the entire world of white people bawl out? When two go down, the whole of them cry. But when 100 million, when tens of millions of black people succumb to death and starvation and sodomization by these same people, we are told that the lives of black people are equivalent to cattle. Where did this ideology develop? And why is it we still hold on to this thinking? How can we unlearn that indoctrination and begin to put value to our real lives and begin to really understand who the beast is, that we can organize to defend ourselves? Because something is amiss. Something is amiss. The families of those victims at the football match, they will probably get reparations. They'll be compensated by the British government. So what is it about the black people that we are not worthy of compensation? We cannot be, there's no reparation for any damage to I and I. So where does the Almighty now come into this unjust situation. We have to check it in and out, up and down, and through the middle. We want to look deeper into what it is to be white. Is white really a color? And does white really exist within the spectrum of colors? Metamorphosis. Begin the interrogation into this idea called white, and the question we kick off with is, when did white become right? And when did white become light? Or better than that, when did light become white? Because the indoctrination to overpower the black meditation to the point we are in total submission to things that are white. It started deep and long ago. So I'm going to begin by even exploring the realm of science, the definitions that have been given to us that we embrace and defending. When did light become white? Because they always slip the word white in front of light. As you always hear about white light. And if you hear the thing over and over and over again, you don't ask any questions. You sort of just sink, have it sink into the subconscious brain. And then the body say light, you just say white. But because the metamorphosis is about perspectives and slowing down and angles and objectives beyond words, we have to explore light. And as the original scientists, the black people, once we do the proper exploration, we're going to realize that what we're calling light, in other words, the energy that radiates from the sun that reaches us here on earth, that we call light, it has no color. How can I say that? Well, light is in its normal, natural state, natural. Light is natural. Natural means there is no color to it. It's see-through. Natural. But when we begin to examine the nature now of light, what are the constituents of light? What is it that makes up light? Really, that light is made up of vibrations. wavelengths of energy. And it is within that context now we come upon the spectrum, the color spectrum, or we come upon the rainbow. The rainbow is a natural occurring spectrum. It is a rainbow that exposes colors that are inside light. So the light from the sun is broken up by the raindrops, and we get a rainbow. Nothing divinely created by any outside forces of nature. You can create a rainbow with a garden hose, depending on where the sun is and where you turn the water. So within our general knowledge, we can clearly state that the vibrations that make up light are called hues, H-U-E-S. Metamorphosis always recommends that you have a little dictionary and a book near you, and your pen and paper and so forth, and a map as tools to explore. So again, when we look back into this old scientific approach to the knowledge of what is white, we can with absolute certainty begin to dismiss white as a property of light. Light is a combination of the seven hues or the seven colors of the rainbow. And in those seven colors, there is no white. And similarly, in those seven hues, there is no black. So right away, we can see now that we have been deceived through the education system to hold on to the idea that light is white. And in the literature, when we want to speak about knowledge and understanding, the metaphor we use is light. So when you begin to see an idea clearly, we say to you, oh, you see the light. So in that equation of seeing the light and coming to knowledge, the intuitively built concept of white goes along with the picture. And so we begin to equate truth and wisdom with white, because the light represents truth and the light is white. So the whole teaching want to be totally thrown out. The whole concept of telling us that white is a light is light is an illusion. It's a blatant lie. But it helps to support the notion of white domination. So we have to explore carefully now, what is it that is it in our own brain that makes us feel inferior to the idea of white, that anything white is right, and that white is superior to things that are not white. We have to stop and think carefully now, you know, because this thing going on too long, and there don't seem to be any fundamental change in the mentality, because the education that we get has not been challenged. It's the same. So the whole idea of white is right and the white is light, and that when people are dying and go close to death, them see a white light. I was just told that very recently, that every time people get these near-death experiences, they come forward and tell you that yes, them see a white light. That is also the indoctrination of religion. They never see a red, green, and gold light. They don't see no other colors. It's always a white light. So you see, until we begin to reject those false ideas, white lives will always matter. And the people who they call non-white, which is another thing we're going to deal with, will always be feeling the brunt. Now, who is non-white? How can you have non-white people if the people who are white are considered in the minority? Metamorphosis.
want to respond to a brethren who just WhatsApp me. Kenny Ward in California. Brethren, plenty of brethren conscious reasoning. And the fact that is that, as I say, a lot of people in America are unwilling to identify themselves as African. And they don't want to speak about race first. But that's the biggest deception and the biggest illusion. And it makes the Caucasian people very happy when they meet African people who are in denial of their own blackness. The way forward is to race consciousness. And that's what is lacking. Seriously. Because of this Christian dumb vibration that keeps Africans dumb to their racial consciousness. So, again, we're looking into what it is to be white. What is white? And scientifically, there is no connection between white and hues. There's no connection between white and the vibrations that emit from the sun that create the different hues, the violet, the indigo, the blue, the green, the red, the yellow, and the red. These are the colors of the rainbow. And black does not exist in that dimension. So shortly we're going to recognize that also that black is not what they tell us. But we hear so much thing about black, we can't leave it for a little while. We could penetrate what is white. What is it that creates this aura around Caucasian people? That people who see them just move out of the way and let them through. What is it that they have told us that makes us genuflect and bow and rub up self and just want to show these people that we are equal? Because they have driven into the black man that he's an inferior. And every time the black man goes amongst a Caucasian, part of his objective is to show the Caucasian that he's equal. Well, what a trick. Yes, and you spend your time trying to prove to the Caucasian that you're equal. And in that proving, you just reinforce in what he's thinking. That you don't reach yourself. And that you don't respect your race first. So the system will continue until the awakening, which is a consciousness of our own blackness. But again, let us explore identity and how is it, particularly in America. The people who are Caucasian, people who came out of Europe and occupied North America, they eventually began to identify themselves as whites. But no more than that, the Africans who they forced and uprooted and brought into this space were now defined as not as Africans anymore. Even before they decided to call the Africans Negroes, they thought it more appropriate to call people non-white. Now this is a very interesting definition, because they came across and they came upon the native Indians. And they begin to call those Indians non-whites. And then they came upon the African people. And they called the African people non-whites. And if you check the whole world population, which has about 7 billion people, and 9/10 of that 7 billion is melanin black-skinned people, what we really have here is a minority of people defining the majority as a none. In other words, we are defined as a negative of these people. We have to be careful now in our re-examine how we define ourselves. And is it we who define ourselves? How can you be non-white when you are in the majority of the world population? The reality is that they are non-black. They are non-black people. And we can't say it away because we're afraid. And we've been trained to think of white always in a superior position. So how many out there are non-white? You better know yourself. You better know your black self.
You know, if you tell a white lie, it ain't no big deal. Yes, a white lie is a little tiny, tiny, itsy bitsy lie. Cause it's white. But you see, if you ever tell a big lie, it's a big black lie. Make a watch over, I think about this white thing. How can they call I non-white? And how can I call myself non-white? How can I define myself as a negative? Mind what we are doing. We are negating ourselves in relationship to another people. So the definitions that we apply within the concept of our identity is what we're looking into. As we look into this idea of white. So are they really white people? What is white? We know that the majority of the people in the world are people of melanin. And the same people who lack melanin try to call those people of color. And we have accepted the definition. Start calling ourselves colored people. People of color. Well, if you slap a white, slap a Caucasian, change his color. Can get red in the neck. Can get blue under the skin. Who is a colored person? So the definitions that they apply to I and I, we have been absorbing these definitions, but they've been applied to us by the Caucasian people. They have called us Negroes. They call us colored. They call us all sorts of things that suit their agenda. And we respond by honoring what is white. So white becomes a symbol of a wedding. Because it's always a great moment of celebration. So we are conditioned to be in full white. And then we are told that when the condition comes for mourning and grief, we must put on full black. So the program is strong. So anything white that gets disturbed is an international problem. But you can kill off black people like flies in the hundreds and the thousands. Ain't nothing that. Black lives don't matter because blackness is a curse according to the teaching. So if you accept the notion of white being virtuous and black being a curse, then you see what you have brought unto yourself. What is it to be white? It's going to be very obvious after a while that it has nothing to do with the skin of the Caucasian. Because the skin is not white. The skin of the Caucasian simply lacks pigmentation. So what does the European mean when he says white? We'll be right back. So, and I now look into the different dimensions then of identity. Because the European has held on to this title, white. And he has convinced us that this is his racial identity. But is it so? Because the European, within his own construction of tribes, have a serious amount of differences amongst themselves. Their history is replete with wars and violence, 100-year war, people being burned to the stake, the Celts versus the Danes and the Normans versus the Vikings, and it's just pure war amongst the tribes of Europe. Francos and the various tribal groups in Europe. So there was a time when the Europeans never even considered and even understood the concept of white. They were so busy in their own wars amongst themselves that their identities were really fixed on nationalities. Because there is a national identity, and you acquire that identity based simply on where you're born, the landmass where you come out. So the Europeans would be engaged in a whole heap of nationalistic type of wars, trying to overpower each other to control Europe. And we know of the great European leaders in the Mussolinis and the Hitlers and the various men who African people would feel the wrath of those men later on. But the point I'm getting at is that within the European evolution, there was not really any way to ascribe the title of white to these people. They were Europeans and they were tribal. So obviously there was a time when white wasn't even applied to Caucasian people. When they were in their caves, they were not considered to be white people. They were simply cavemen. And the significant difference between the caveman and the people of the rest of the world who were civilized is that the rest of the world were melanin people, Orientals and Africans. And the uncivilized barbarians were coming out of the caves of Europe. So even at that point in time, there was nothing to speak about white. But this idea of white people really began to develop when the Europeans began to sail out of Europe and began to integrate and get involved with the other groups and races of people around the world. And became conscious that they were really a minority in the world. Everywhere they went, they saw black people. They saw people of pigmentation. They saw people of melanin everywhere them sailed. And Dr. Francis Cress Welsing, great psychologist and psychiatrist who just passed on, made it very clear to us that the Europeans understood that if they continue to have sexual relations with the people of melanin, after a while, they would no longer exist as Europeans. They would be browned out, and they would be mixed out, and they would be blackened out. So the Europeans, in their own wisdom and desire to protect themselves, developed an idea, an ideology that would protect them collectively, especially when they leave out of Europe. Because in Europe, there were warriors amongst themselves, you know. They used to war and kill one another. But they realized that once they leave Europe and come out into the greater world where the 9/10 population exists of African, Asian, and Oriental people, they would have to have something to rally around, something that they would unite around. And so they developed this idea called whiteness. It's an idea. It's an ideology called whiteness. And so everywhere they went, they would project a political identity called whiteness. Yeah, so whiteness is not a racial identity. It's a political identity developed by the Caucasian people of Europe. And so they rally around whiteness. So anywhere the European is affected, you get the feeling that there's a commonality amongst all of the European people because they defend one another under the ideology of whiteness. So whiteness become a political doctrine. And African people are overrun now by these forces and have been indoctrinated and trained to accept the idea of white as a people, and that white people are now the superior people on the planet. We have to check how we arrive at this, you know, because in the real world, these are European people. These are Caucasians who have left Europe generally and occupied North America and have established their powers militarily and economically on the backs of African people. Is African people time to shake off this unnecessary weight? But the ideology, we have to clear it up out of our brains first. We have to stop bowing to things that are called white. We have to begin to have a knowledge of imagery. And that imagery of Caucasian people is just an image. The concept of black is what we need to revisit. Because it's very clear that white doesn't really symbolize right. So what then is justice without blackness?
Stars FM, you're my number one.
Watch out! I see the Marsh and this time you represent for Ramit. You don't know, see the Rough Up the World edition. What's your name? Hit name. This are the set no set no. When governor all set no. Portland I bring real dance all set no. Live in concert, Virgin, CZ the Martian, Tamar Blueprint. Watch and you don't know, see a Saturday, April the 30th, don't forget. Music by Stereo Mars Sound, DJ Iceberg, DJ Sheffy, DJ O'Neill, DJ Steady, Crystal Nightclub parking lot. You don't know, so that a Port Antonio, Portland. Admission of 1,000 pre-sold and 1,500 at the gate. Come out early, don't be late. How they sit no, sit no, we govern all sit no. Portland a ring, real dance all sit no. Rum it, form is the key.
Build as Depot, everybody go a Build as Depot. Portland number one hardware, that's a Build as Depot. You want to fix up your yard,
Build as.
You could be living abroad,
Build as.
Hurricane season come,
Build as.
So make your roof blow a dung,
Build as.
We have the best pricing,
Build as.
And the best parking,
Build as.
Harbor Dash, we are waiting. And we are carrying the swing.
Build us Depot, right at Industrial Estate, Long Wall in Burns Bay. I call them at 715-3128 or 284-3337. Check them out.
Planning a party, club night out, stage show, a gospel concert, or even a business sales event? Let Styles FM be a part of your promoting tool. Take advantage of our low-priced promotion packages with commercials, interviews, giveaways, reviews, and much more. We have special offers when you mix and match and bundle your options. Contact us at 876-286-9216 or 439-5160. Styles FM, for the most effective way to exploit your marketing dollar.
Hey, are you ready? You ready? All right. All right, let's go. Do you know what time it is? Do you know what time it is? Yes, it's on a Saturday. Every Saturday morning, live on Stars 96.1, the People Station. Here's an invitation to join yours truly, Colin Anthony, the man with all the money, honey. The program is called Smooth Sailing. Every Saturday morning from 9 o'clock until 1 on the PM. It's going to be on Stars FM 96.1. Have you got a plan? You've got a plan? We've got a plan. Do remember to join us. Smooth sailing.
Are you ready for the time of your life?
Remember Styles FM on social media. View us on YouTube at Styles FM Radio. Follow us on Instagram at Styles FM. Like us on Twitter at Styles FM 961. Become a fan on Facebook. Styles FM 96.1.
Metamorphosis want to feature Ja Bunny Wailer. Bunny Wailer is on tour now and celebrating an outstanding album made 40 years ago called The Black Heart Man. At a time when people were still running around hiding their children, thinking that the Black Heart Man would rob and steal their children. We still have that meditation hanging over the country. Because there's still a fear of the man with the black heart. If the man had a white heart, yeah, maybe we'd glorify him. Listen to Bunny Wailer.
The Rasta come from Zion, Rasta man a lion. Rasta come from Zion, Rasta man a lion. In Irie, remember Jeremiah, children.
Rasta man is one of the first man them to begin to challenge the whole white imagery of Caucasian people in the dominant positions all the while. Because the Rasta man now was the black man on this side of the hemisphere who was unwilling to abandon the African consciousness. And within that African consciousness rest the seeds of blackness. So the identity of Caucasian people being shrouded now in this political identity called whiteness. And they try to twin both identities as a political and as a racial. So the racial identity now becomes conflated with the political identity. And we call all European people now white. And we ascribe to all of these people a certain amount of power. Economical and political power. The Rastaman now, within the context of this Jamaican plantation, again, really began to think deeper into the whole relationship between the slave and the owner. And recognize that the slave really had a history, and the history didn't begin at the capture, but the history is more ancient and long before there was even Caucasian people who had any literacy. So the view developed now by Rastafari in examining the images that we got out of the Christian Bible, it became a problem, because the Caucasian imagery did not suit and fit the imagery of the Rastaman. It was obviously contradictory. But the Caucasian would call himself white, and we would begin to call him white people. And then if you look into the scripture, the very Bible, in the very first page, in the first book, it tells you that the Creator God said, let there be light. And there was light. So the imagination thinks of light as white. And it continues further to say that the light was separated from the darkness, and the light was good. So the early implication is that light is good and that white is good. And of course, the darkness, which is not good, and the darkness symbolizes evil. And the darkness also symbolizes the people who are dark-skinned. So there is a coordinated program to convince I and I of the supremacy and the superiority of what is white. We talk about identities in Jamaica regular. And when the Rastaman or the African Center people try to tell other Jamaicans, black people here, that they're Africans, them say no. They're not Africans because they're never born in Africa. They're born in Jamaica. You can't question where the person is born. But we can help them to understand the extent of where identity will take them. So, again, everybody who's born on the planet Earth has a national identity, because that's related to the place where you're born. But identity goes deeper than the place where you're born, because it goes into your history, it goes into the culture of your people. So the Jamaicans who are here now, the black people who say they're Jamaicans and they're not Africans because they were born in Africa, they should speak to the Chinaman and the Indians who were never born in India or China, but have no problem embracing China, their Chinese identity, and their Indian identity. The people who we're calling white people, if a German, if a Caucasian is born in Germany, they will call him a German. If you come to Jamaica and you have a child here, the child would also be a Jamaican by nationality. But we would call the child white. So why do we refer to that aspect of the identity, the white, rather than speak to the side that is German? In other words, now, we have to look at how we think and check out our own thinking and see if we have to make any kind of adjustments. Because we're always glorifying European people within the context of whiteness. And we're always denigrating African people based upon the concept of them being black. And we're always having this training that black and white are opposites. And in art school, they tell them that they're shades. But there are no other colors that are opposite. Because if black and white are opposite colors, what is opposite of red? What's opposite of blue? So something is not correct in our perception of this idea of white. And the more we can break down this imagery that white projects itself to be, is easier we're going to see who these people are. Easier we'll see who these Caucasian people are. And why is it when 96 of them are killed, there's a great clamor and even the Prime Minister will come out and mourn the loss of 96 English football supporters. The same Prime Minister would never say sorry for the atrocities committed by England against millions and millions of African people. So what is it about the black life, why it don't matter? And what is it about the white life that it matters so much? What is it about these people that we think that they are more important to life than us? How did they get onto that pedestal? Who put them on that pedestal that we now glorify them in the way we treat almost our deities? Do we see white people as deities? Just asking. Do we see them as deities because of the imagery given to us about this father and son? This father and son company that controls heaven and the limited spaces that all these black people are trying to get in. What is it? So the people who are classified as non-white, they are now moving away from non-white into brown. Yes, they are now brown, off-brown, high-brown. Yes, that's where we're gone with the non-white. And we soon talk about the aliens. How did people become classified as aliens? And then the illegal alien. It dread.
And from that day on, there is trouble. From that day on, we've got wars and rumors of wars. Nations rising up against nation, mother against daughter, father against son, little children having children. In this Yahweh, the holy, the holy, it's the Armageddon. In a high region, I see light fighting against darkness, righteousness against evil, right battling against wrong. Here comes bondage struggling for freedom. Redemption, it says, blessed are the poor,
they shall inherit the earth.
Blessed are the meek,
they shall have birth.
Them that hunger and thirst after righteousness, them alone shall be called blessed. In this Yahweh, the boy. Taking place in a high.
I'd like to say Babylon fail. There is one like unto a flames of fire. His name I can tell. He is conquering and to conquer the gates of doom and hell. And life, long life, is his reward. To them that are good. As for the heathen, in their hearts, his name is terrible and dreadful. In this Yahweh, 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 it's the
symbols and signs are important tools of communication, and these are ways in which we store information in our subconscious brain. Symbols, signs carry a lot of information. And so in your own thinking, you need to arrive at the consensus within yourself. What and how do you view the symbol of good as opposed to the symbol of evil? Do you still view evil as black? Because once you hold that view, then the binary opposition, binary idea clicks in, and therefore the opposite of evil is good, and you are left believing that the opposite of black is white. And so we locked up into this binary again, with this black and white and good and evil. There is also another state called indifference, which would be neither black nor white. And then the whole idea of the deities now, the sources of good and the ultimate source of evil. We have to begin to re-examine some of these ideas. Because it is a Christian scripture that really de-emphasizes race and try to give the people the impression that everybody is one and that we are all human beings. Now, this is a very interesting perspective, you know. Because if we are all human beings, why is it that the white human being is privileged? And why is it that the Caucasian human being, why is it that the human being who lacks melanin is in the position of domination? So what is so specific about that human being? So again, we talk about good and evil, and we project behind those ideas imageries, and we go into the movies and we see that the star and the hero is usually clothed in white, and that the villain usually have dark clothing. So these images work deep into the subconscious brain. And it affects us in such a way that we have women who blacker than me having this great desire for white looking children. Children with less melanin. Children who could be classified as perhaps nearly white. Because we're under the illusion that the less melanin the child has in the skin is a better chance the child has to survive in the society. Because the society is glorifying the people who are Caucasian and the people who lack the melanin in them system. So the bleachers and the permas and the people who are trying to depigmentalize themselves, these are the people who have the least amount of understanding. And these are the people who will glorify and debase at the same time their own African selves. So we just try to provide some different perspective as to what is this thing called white and why we think that white is right. And why do we have mercy for people who call themselves white? And why are we so cruel and merciless to the people who are of our own pigment nature? Something is in the education system that is promoting this idea of European Caucasian people as white people, and that white people are superior people. African people need to be more conscious and begin to explore a little bit more our own genesis. Because, you know, in the teachings within the genesis of African people, we are told that there is a source of good and there's a source of evil. And the source of good is represented by the light. And if we continue to accept that light is white, then there is no hope. But if we wake up to the consciousness that light is natural and that light is a combination of hues of which there is no white hue, they will begin to break down the fallacy of white supremacy.
Conviction, yeah. Battering down sentence, fighting against conviction. I find myself growing in an environment where finding food is just as hard as paying the rent. In trodding these roads of trial and tribulation, I've seen where some have died in desperation to keep battering down sentence, fighting against conviction. Battering down sentence, conviction. In a family of 10 and raised in the ghetto, hustling's the only education I know. Can't grow no crops in this concrete jungle. A situation like this is getting too tough to handle. Keep battering down sentence, fighting against conviction. Battering down sentence, all day long, fighting against conviction. With a pregnant woman, yes, and 5 kids to care for. Can't cool my heels, I've got to do the town. Skillful as I am, the jailer man is bound to find me. I pray the day will come when I shall be free from battering down sentence, fighting against conviction.
Rastaman spent enough time behind prison walls because of the defense of his identity as an African. So the concept of race first has been upheld by Rastafari and was strongly promoted by Marcus Messiah Garvey. You have to ask yourself, which identity is your foundation? Is it your national identity or is it your racial identity? What is the foundation of your makeup? Because the national identity you recognize is easily changed. You can swap it. But can you swap your racial identity? Maybe you can try to hide that, but can you swap it? Can you exchange it without destroying your own being? So Rastaman feel enough oppression for embracing the identity of Africa. The European will embrace his ethnicity. He will defend himself being a Pole or English or he's a German or Italian. But when the crisis really come in the world struggle against the other peoples of the world, we don't hear about the ethnic makeup. We hear that it's white people. We don't hear say the Bosnians anymore and it's the Ukrainians and these various tribal groups that are always at war. The Armenians and these various groups. We don't hear that anymore. We hear says white people. So they know when to unite. And when they unite, it's around the idea of being white. They know that they are not white. That it's a political identity. They have their ethnicity and they have their racial makeup, which is obvious. They are Caucasoids. So the black people, we begin to decide in ourselves, not just in the Caribbean, but particularly in North America, where we have wealthy black people clinging on to the identity of being an American. And black people in positions of power and influence claiming that they are not African. Them lost in the money that them have. They are totally lost. Oprah and some other people who confused because the system buy them out. At the foundation, all of us as black people must rally around our racial identity. National identity comes and goes. We have Europeans who are here now boasting that they are now Jamaicans. Because I'm here long enough now to get a Jamaican citizenship. And we have many, many of our people in other countries boasting to be citizens of those countries as well. So nationality come and go, you know. Yeah, and we can't go on like it is an ending all. Because you have to born somewhere. You're born in an aeroplane. Them give you an identity nationally according to maybe which country you're going to or where the plane is in the era or which airline it's upon. Something go on. But the racial identity, anytime we begin to get more cognizant, more comfortable, embracing the fullness of our racial identity, then we begin to see results in terms of resistance. Because if you resist against white domination and you lack your racial consciousness, you can't win. You can't win because it is their racial unification that allows them to have a common front. The fact that them claims that they are white people, as much as they differ in their ethnicity, them rally around whiteness. Well, you see, for black people, it's two things. It's a political identity and it's a racial identity. The role of the Black Panther Party was very significant in America. It showed the importance of black people rallying around blackness as their political ideology. So blackness is both a political label and a racial label. So that's why black people must hug it up two times. Yeah, man, must hug it up twice. We must black. And understand what it means. And in saying that, we're not preventing Caucasian people from claiming themselves to be white. And I don't care about that. What's important that we begin to recognize that we are black people and we are called ourselves black people, and we're going to begin to build our communities and our economics around the fact that we are black people. So who want to keep them head in the sand and pretend that they are human beings? And because they are human beings, they have dismissed their African identity. On a loss. Yeah, on a like people and drugs. You have been caught up by the system. And you're not yourself. Metamorphosis. Dr. Iman Black. Ancient and the great Bunny Wailer, the last of the living Wailers. Jabi, the man with the voice and the man with the lyrics. And the man who is defending the foundation of Rastafari. And that the fact that Africa is our father motherland. Expressed in the song Dreamland. But it's really the land of the visionaries. The land of the creators. And in that land, the people were black. And the people are black. The land was called Kemet. So the history of black is real. As a scientific concept, it is the state of absorbing all energy. Within the scientific community, anything that is black has a capacity to hold energy and to store energy or to absorb energy. So in the scientific world of today, we keep hearing about black holes and dark matter. These are forces that have nothing to do with white. And in these forces, it is the blackness that is the power. These forces are so black that no energy can escape, which is why these things are black. There is no way any type of light or energy can escape. And so blackness is ancient. Blackness is a state of nature. Blackness is in existence long before European people came out of the caves. As an idea, as a people, as a politics, we have the concept of black. But all of that has been reversed because of religious training. And everything black now has become evil. And the converse is that now everything that is white now is perfect and pure. And you open your dictionary, and you look up the meaning of the word white. It's all about spotless and purity and cleanliness and good virtue. And you turn to the dictionary, look at the black, you see dirty and spoiled and all of these negative conditions. And so people tend to attach these conditions to the identity of being black. And likewise, they attach the same properties and qualities to white. So we have a lot of unlearning to undergo because of what they have been telling us and what they've been calling an education. And it's not a very easy task because of the reinforcement of the media and the fact that people are just generally fearful. We are actually told to believe that evil happens when night comes. And so when night comes, make sure you pray when you sleep. You don't have to pray in the daytime, you know. You can sleep at days, during the day, and you don't pray before you go to sleep in the day, because you're going to wake up. But when people go to bed at night, they are bound to pray because they want guidance and they want security now through the darkness. Because in the darkness now, that's when evil rule, you know. Boy, I mean, I tell you the thing, wicked power brain, you know. In other words, wicked evil don't rule in the sunlight, you know. No, because light is white and everything is pure. And you know, so the thing backwards. The thing is running backwards. And it's only I and I can reverse the curse. We have to undo the learning that we have as given and to reorganize our thought processes with proper knowledge. There is one thing to believe. There's one thing to know. The people who are afraid of reality dwell in the land of belief, in the land of superstition, and the land of fear. The people who are practical, the people who are builders of society, and pyramids and sphinxes. No time to dream. These people are visionaries. And so there's no fear in thinking. So there's much to meditate on. Why is it we feel inferior when we come amongst people who are considered to be white? Why is it in the marketplace when you are buying and you're being attended to, and a European come, the seller will stop, notice you right away, and start dealing with the people. So in other words, the money from the white man has more value in it than the way the black man gave it the same money. So deep is the brainwashing of bowing to things that are white. But ultimately, you know, if you go into your church, and you go into your religious domain, and you look up onto the wall for your divine savior. And that savior has the image of a European that we call white. Then you see where the destruction really rests. We have to free yourself of those images. Not only out of the physical image, out of the church and the books, but the images that are in our brain. Those are the ones that are harder to remove. And those are the ones we must spend time and removing if we intend to really heal ourselves. The African man have a serious dilemma. Not even a dilemma, a serious issue to face. Every time we talk about issues of gender now. Because at the level of gender, we talk about male and female. And here now, the European female has been hoisted up on a high pedestal. And there's a desire that surrounds her, where African men are socialized and educated to desire this white female. And what are some of the features that surround this white female? One of the things, you know, we have to reflect consistently now is on the plantation life, wherein Bakra spent enough of him time raping off black women, you know, sodomizing black men because of the level of power and control they had. And him leaving the black man used to get hung for what they call ogling in America. They would lynch him because he looked at a white woman. A lot of black men would be brutalized because white women tell lie upon them, say them that look them. So the white man, the European, the male, create a thing around his woman that somehow it leaves a deep desire in the African to get this woman. Because look at the plantation life. This little lily white, thin-lipped woman standing up on a platform on some veranda. Breeze blowing through her hair. We see these things in the movies. An African man then begin to desire this female, this white girl. And so the white girl becomes almost a prize in the brain of enough black people, enough black man. And it's a very complex issue because there are some black men who literally feel inferior to white people, Caucasian generally. And sometimes he may believe that in taking on this female white woman, he will have achieved equality in the eyes of white people because he now has one of their women. It causes pain to the white man as well. So the white female becomes an object. Become an object in the whole power and control of African people. So it's something that we have to really examine carefully. Why is it that the black man desires this white woman? I see in America, probably the richest black man coming out of the world of sports, whose name is Michael Jordan. And I was shocked when I looked on a site and saw Jordan walking with a little white girl claiming that this now is his wife. That girl could be his daughter. And I keep wondering, what is it that black man keeps seeing in these white women? And what is it that these little white women have that they can rope in or the richest, most successful black man? That deep programming that we have to revisit. Is it a sign of real inferiority? Is it a way that black man think him can climb the ladder of success? Tiger Woods. Why is it that all of our successful entertainers generally end up with white women? So I and I have to check out carefully now, you know, how them program us. Why do we devalue black women at that stage? What is the problem amongst I and I? Why the wealthy black man can't reach to the highest level of his wealth with a black woman? What is in the system? Because we don't see the other way around. We don't see rich white men taking on black women. We don't see that. Because there's a conscious effort, obviously, by white people to maintain their whiteness. And so in Georgia, where there was this white power march, what the white people were demanding the Caucasians in America was to end the process of diversity, because to them diversity equals white genocide. And one think about that carefully, because black people have been so busy fighting for integration, trying to be near white people, and here we have white people now fighting to stay away from black people. We have to think about this seriously now, you know, because we're under the illusion that we are all human beings, and that is not, that is where the illusion is greatest, because the African people are Africans, the Europeans are Europeans. The Europeans come up with the concept of human being, coming out of the Darwinian evolutionary theory. It don't fit African people. And I will never hold on to that concept of being a human being. I'm an African. Yeah, I'm always an African. And Africans have been in the earth long before the concept of human being. A human being is an evolution of the primates, according to the theory of Darwin. African people have been here long before any evolution of the apes began. So and I will never hold that concept of being a human being. I is a man. And I is African. In case you can't see. Metamorphosis, moving into Alkibu land, our story. Kemet, this is a sound that would represent the people of the continent, the Kemetic people. Before we were classified as Egyptians and Ethiopians and Negroes and all these various terms. We are Kemetic people. And the first translation of Kemet is really black. The way the carbon is black, representation of the carbon in the chemical chart. Now, the thing about our story is that in the present time, as we speak in this moment, and from the times of Garvey in the 20s, the ideology of race first was presented to us as a way to reorganize and regroup. It's a practice used by nearly all other groups. The Chinese, the Indians, even religious groups like the Jews would promote the concept of, well, them Jew first, them religion first. For African people, it is very, very important that we come to a common understanding of what will be the pillars of our reconstruction as a nation of people. What will be the principles? They're already established, you know, for I and I to reconfigure them in a way that is beneficial. The idea of race first. Somehow, when you speak amongst black people about race first, it's as if you are telling them that you are dismissing the other races. And the people will say to you that you are no racist. And there's a clear definition, distinction between a person who is racist and a person who is racially conscious. So the racially conscious person is conscious about the history and culture of their race and the achievements and the various struggles of their race. The person who practices or who be classified as a racist is a person who is practicing oppression against other persons because of the difference in their race from theirs. Very kind of simplistic way to look at it. Well, you know, you can always expand on what the various differences are. I want to just try to speak a little bit about the idea of race, because in the present time, the people in the academic world, the academias, especially the Europeans, they are trying to drive across this idea that there's no such thing as race. I see enough of my, what you call, former colleagues at the University of West Indies defending this very, very stoutly, finding all kind of arguments to justify that race is a, what they're calling, a social construct. Yeah, many, many universities around the world now are pushing this idea. In other words, there's no such thing as race. But we are all humans, according to the teaching. Well, I don't hold that. Because if you heard me earlier, I am not embracing this human talk. I is man. I is no human. I is man. And that hu prefix needs to be worked out to understand what it really means to attach hu to man. Because man is the foundation. Man is the original man. So the man is African. Yeah, man represents African. Capital M, capital A, capital N. The original inhabitants of this planet, based upon all the research, are African people. So when the Christian Bible tells that God said, let us make man and send them out to multiply and replenish the earth, there was no concept of human. So even the religious context, there is no human. It's man. Human is an introduction, as I say, to scientific research and Darwinian analysis of the primates who moved to Homo erectus and Homo sapien and all these homos. That is not the tradition of African people. So again, let us return to the idea of race. What is it that defines a person's race? And we have to look into the anatomy now and the physiology of the person, the physical makeup. The first observation, or the first awareness of a person basically is through the visuals. What you see, who you see. So it is the visuals that help us to define our makeup, our identity, what a person look like. And we begin to go into what race is about now. The makeup of the person, we have to trace it from egg and sperm. And the fact that these are forces that are being sent along by the parents. So the father sends along the sperm and the mother sends along the egg. But in these two life forms, or energy forms, is enough information. A lot of information. Information about the father and information about the mother. So when these forces come together and we know of a unit, this unit now has the first markings of identity. In other words, the egg by itself have a consciousness, but we wouldn't call it, say it has an identity. Likewise, the sperm. There's a consciousness in it, there's an energy, but we're not going to say that it has an identity. But when they merge, the egg and the sperm, we can begin to speak about an identity now being formed. The fusion, a unity, something being created that will have an identity. So as that thing evolves, you know, I'm going to move through the field of embryology to come out as a living being. The first structure is the skin, because the forces that meet need protection. So when the egg and the sperm connect, whatever is going to become the individual needs protection, and the first level of protection is the skin. Now we need to know this carefully and begin to deal with our skin in a different way. It's the first level of protection. It's the first organ of sensation. So eventually when the person, what we call born, or emerges out of the parent, we see the skin. Not only do we see the skin, we see other aspects of the person. We see what the skin has eventually push out, which is the hair. And we begin to see features. Now these are the features that we're going to use to help to identify the race of the person. These are the features. So the skin becomes a signifier of the race that you belong to. There's a word called species. Some people think that we are all species, another form of life. But plants also have species. Animals have species, various groupings. But in the concept of man, we use the word race. So the race of man, the original race of man, if we look at the skin of that man had melanin in the skin. The climatic conditions of that original man is of African nature, tropical climate. So your skin becomes your first signifier. Out of the skin grows the hair. Out of the same layer of the skin grows the colors of the eye. So there are some significant features that we use to define race. And as I said, there are those people today who are trying to dismiss race, to claim that we are all humans. But in that dismissal of race, you're also dismissing the concept of being African. And you're trying to dismiss the concept of being Oriental and being Indian. These are groups of man that have different physiological makeup because of climatic conditions. So race is genetic, it's biological, it is also supported by environment. So when the black man says race first, it means the people of melanin, the people of black pigmentation first. All things come after.
quality in sound reinforcement and backlining, native audio. We have professional engineers with over 20 years of experience. So call us and we'll take care of your parties, wedding receptions, barbecues, conferences, and small stage shows. Crystal clear sound, native audio. Our prices are the best. Call us at 871-5212. That's 871-5212. Native audio. We make your events audible.
I say in one version, but the version I represent. I mean, say April 30, 2016. A thing called Rummit, Rough Up the World Edition. Place to be, Crystal Nightclub, parking lot, Portland. I miss a rough them up, Mr. Quefty. I know a live performance by I myself version. Tamara Blueprint, CG, rough them up.
Girl, me no know where you get such a good body from, but it tie me, it tie me. Girl, you little and cute, full of grip, full of glue. Girl, it tiny, it tiny.
Planning a party? Club night out, stage show, a gospel concert, or even a business sales event, let Styles FM be a part of your promoting tool. Take advantage of our low-priced promotion packages with commercials, interviews, giveaways, reviews, and much more. We have special offers when you mix and match and bundle your options. Contact us at 876-286-9216 or 439-5160. Styles FM for the most effective way to exploit your marketing dollar.
Ladies and gentlemen, Changi has turned it up loud in your ears, waking you up out of your bed every Saturday morning with a jump start from 6 a.m. to 9 a.m. The jump start with more music continuously all morning long with your host, Changi, Styles FM, number one.
Architects, draftsmen, and surveyors, get your drawings printed in high-quality professional standards. We can satisfy your printing needs. Whether it is for presentation to your clients or for submitting building and subdivision application, make it VJ Printing Services. Whether drawing by hand or with computer-aided softwares, we will plot your negatives and print the copies as you need. We do high-quality white paper printing that is water-resistant and never fades, unlike traditional blueprint. For more information, call VJ Printing at 893-2266.
No more.
Aspect of the African that needs to be highlighted, that contributes to identity along the line of race. So there's skin, there's hair, there's eye. It's all about melanin and pigmentation. But at the level of the in the anatomy now, within the black man, and within all beings that they call human, there is a tree, a glandular tree called the endocrine system. This is a very important and a major makeup in what you call living beings, man, both man and human beings. And here we're going to see a significant difference now between the African and the European. And they don't emphasize this and they don't tell us because they want to create the illusion that we are all equal. But there is a difference. And in this difference now we may redefine who is supreme and who is not. The endocrine system is a system of glands in the body. It's like a tree. And it begins at the gonads, meaning at the level of the sex organs. And it goes from the sex organs straight up, right up into the body, up to the throat, up into the top of your head. It's a tree. It's called the endocrine system. A tree of glands. And glands are important for the body to function. The glands have to release hormones. And the hormones are what speed up reactions and get certain things moving in the system. Now this is important, you know. Hormones as a production of the body. But if you travel up the tree, that endocrine system of glands, and you start with the sex organs, and you go through the stomach and the past the adrenal glands and the thyroid gland, the gland in the throat, and then when you get up into the head, what the Europeans have told us through their education system is that there is the highest gland on the tree. They tell us something that is not true. They tell us about a gland that they don't know about, and because they don't know about it, they don't teach us. You have an idea about the glands? Cassidy said no. Good. Well, in the African people, there is a gland that is called the pineal gland. P-I-N-E-A-L. Now, this gland is the master gland in the African's body. But in the European, in 96% of the Europeans, this particular gland is calcified. Calcified means it dry up. It can't work. It doesn't work. So the pineal eye, or the pineal gland, is the master gland in the African. It does not function in the European. So I need now to go to search out the powers of this gland. What are the hormones that are created by this gland? And you're going to find that there's a connection between the hormones created by the pineal gland and the fact that we have melanin in our skin. That there is a gland that produces a hormone called that helps us to develop melanin. And melanin is the key to the blackness. Melanin is the key to our greatness. So because we lack the knowledge of ourselves, and we lack the knowledge of the pineal gland, we think that we must struggle to prove to the European that we are their equal. When it is out of the pineal gland came the construction of the pyramid itself.
Everybody does a run, come with it. But Israel don't have it down.
So when you check out certain things for yourself now, you know, along the line of the biological makeup of black people, they tell us that the highest gland is the pituitary gland. That them tell me, you know, all in a school. Them tell you at the university level. And they tell you everywhere we go. You know, for them system of learning, that the pituitary gland is the master gland. It is the master gland in the European. Because there is no other gland above the pituitary gland in the European makeup. But you see, if you check the African, we have another gland. We have a gland that is higher than the pituitary gland on the same tree. And that's what separates us now from them. This is the basis of our divinity. It's the foundation of our ability to connect with the environment. To speak about things spiritual. To speak about things cosmic. So the concept of race is vital if you really want to come to the full power and knowledge of thyself. They talk about the blood and about blood run through our veins and everybody has the same blood. The African blood is not the same as the European blood. We don't have any Irish monkey factor in our blood. The European has Irish factor and the Irish was found in the rhesus monkey. So if we really do the anatomy and the physiological examination of the African who is classified as black, and you compare it to the European who calls themselves white, there's no comparison. It's like God and man. And in the history of African people, the Africans were always gods. The men were the gods and the women were goddesses. We have lost that memory and we have been reduced now to skittle and dog and hoe and bitch and roof, all kind of animal behavior, because we have lost the connection to our own pineal gland. So we need to exercise and to redevelop the pineal gland. The ancients call it the eye of Heru. The orientals call it the third eye. For the black original man, it is the original eye. And so once we begin to resurrect all of these things, whether people are white or blue or green, we have no significance. Because we would have rallied around race first. Metamorphosis, moving into the deconstruction of allegories and mythologies and fables and rhymes and how these devices of English are dropped into the subconscious brain, and they work on us overnight. While we sleep, these ideas take root. We get up in the morning with some serious foolishness in our heads. Fully grown seeds of folly. But in the allegories, these allegories are really generally preserved in the book of King James, called the Bible. And one of the first allegories that I think we need to reverse is the order of the creation story between the male and the female. Now, there's nowhere out in nature, nowhere out in nature that you can identify the female emerging out of a male. There is no form of life, no species, no kingdom, no nothing, wherein the male is the bearer of the fruit. So life always emerges from out of the female. So even if you put on our eggs on the outside, and they are fertilized on the outside, we still recognize the female as a source of life. So if that is how it is to all life kingdoms, whether it's insect or whether it's animal, the female, out of the female comes other life forms. So with that in existence as a reality, how now can I accept an allegory that explains my existence coming out of a man? How can a race of people be cajoled into a mythology that speaks to women, the female coming out of the male? I am saying that is a total reversal of reality. And so when they give us the mythology of Eve coming out of the rib of Adam, we have to completely reject that. That is a complete reversal the way to the state of nature. So if we flip it around and recognize that, hey, what if Eve was created first? What if it was a female that was first created? And out of the female came a male. How that story sound? Nobody can tell us that we can't think that. Because it matches reality in nature. In that the female is really the bearer of the fruit. And out of the female comes all the life forms that maintain the continuity of that species or that race. So right away, Eve and Adam sound more practical than Adam and Eve. And in the African tradition, it makes more sense for the woman be in that position, because in the reality, she is really the head of the household. She's the whole of the family together. She's the mother of the nation. So within the African tradition, how can we reverse that and see her coming out of a man? That's the first alien trick. It's the first reversal that sends the black people in a different direction. And so the black man takes on this ideological framework that puts him in a position now to be dominant over all things. And what African people have in a relationship is not dominance, but cooperation. It's cooperation that makes relations take prosper, and it's not dominance. So we don't need to be dominant. We need to be cooperative. So the old myth and allegory of Adam and Eve should be reversed. That we can reset the woman now in her rightful position. We can return her to the Trinity. And we can easily now remove the ghost or the spirit and inject the African woman into that divinity. Because it's from the African woman comes all forms of people and races and shades. So how can we abandon that knowledge to accept an allegory that we actually came out of a man, ribs, woman? No way. Not practical. We burn that one.
Yes, we're getting stronger.
Can you hear me? Ross? Ross? I know you're not sound. Oh, yeah, you there now?
Hello?
Yes, I. Yeah, man, you're live, you know. You're live in the Metamorphosis.
Yeah, man, give thanks.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I'm in the Pastafari University of Higher Life Learning.
As is?
All the vice chancellors and all the members. And everyone who in tune and following Rastafari University of Higher Life Learning and what it's all about.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So,
the most main thing that I think we should reject the allegory that has been presented to I and I.
Mm.
I was asking them if they have a Bible in front of the eye to read Revelation 5 verse 3. And if we clearly overstand what it said,
yeah,
right, we'll get rid of the brand name that they give and they use not to enlighten us but to enslave us with Jesus. Right?
Yeah.
Which bring us to the core of being fishers of men. So that I think where me thinking most important thing for an IFA to reject, you know?
So you can tell I what Revelation 5 say?
research, you know.
Okay, you don't have it right in front of you then.
And you look everywhere. They look everywhere.
Yeah.
Under the earth, of earth.
Yes.
Heaven, there's no where the angel could find this man. So where was this man?
So what are you saying?
So I'm gonna say, right there.
Yeah.
There, this man wasn't in existence. That's the where the lie been told, because Revelation is supposed to reveal all the things that, and this is supposed to sum up everything that from the beginning.
Yeah.
Right. So this man, the man that's supposed to be worthy to do this honorable work, and all them searching for this man, there's no way they could find this man. So where this man should be hiding?
Yes, I'm on hiding. So where is this man? Where is this man?
Can I hear the sound?
Yeah, man, but why help my listeners to know what I'm going on? Where is this man?
That's the answer right now. Where I want supposed to find within themselves.
I hear you.
If I want really, I check the fullness. What's been happening within and around I and I.
Yeah. So I giving out some instructions now to ones who are listening that them should go and check Revelations 5, verse 3.
Yes, I.
And do some undercover work and see if you can come up with some information that can help liberate yourself.
Naturally.
Yes, I. Well, I think the listeners listening, and them have access to the information. So we're gonna leave it at that then. Make them pursue the knowledge, you know.
Thanks.
All right. Rask Gudamore.
Man.
Isis.
As one day know, as they know, is Rask Gudamore, you know?
Yeah, man. Rask Gudamore, man. All the while.
You're the big man.
From in the mango. In the Bronx mango.
That's the far right.
All right, my brother. One love. Here, sir.
Just dancing love. My love.
I agree. Yeah, the program is running rapid, and within the I-1 movements, if you were listening first week, you heard about the penultimate delivery, and we had an understanding cricket. After that delivery comes the final delivery, and then the match will continue at some other point in time. So for now, we just keep the metamorphosis moving. What's going on? I need to heal all some people who think, say, they have been forgotten. I want to begin with Valerie. What is real Valerie from Springbank? Yeah, I want to heal Patrick and Dirks from over there in Norwich. I want to heal the Colonel from behind the community of Anchovy. And I want to heal up Lancey and his family, daughters and wife, up there in Chateauva. I want to heal D has been a virgin who has been with the metamorphosis from that time till this time. And of course, I want to heal the Dominus them, Pitchfield Hill, Miss Roma, and Willow, and Claude, and Kenny, and Sir D, and the rest of the man them who play some domino when there's no lights because the moon shining bright. Great. So within the globe, so here's some other people, you know, because we're into the final half an hour, and there are a lot of people on the Facebook that I have some good relations with. I want to hail them up and thank them for participating, following the metamorphosis,
Philip White and Alan Green, Philip Tolliver, Kasha Block, Donald Veal, Aston Shaw, and the name goes on. And of course, there's Christina Gardner and Joy from upstate, Joy in the Bronx, and Ross Triss and Grace. And there's a whole lot of people still over these 7 years of bowling frantic pace. But in the current dispensation of time now, we're dealing with Trump. And Trump versus Clinton is what is working down to in America. And the world is watching because America is this great big global democracy that sets the examples. And within the struggle, we see the Trump who really representing the masses of the wealthy and the Ku Klux Klan and those who are white at heart. And then we see Clinton representing the LGBT agenda and the people who are fighting against natural sex. People who are trying to insist that gender is not important because he can become she and she can become he and they both can become it. So there's a whole lot of things happening in North America as they come down to their decision as who will be two main contenders for the presidency. And in that same place, as I said earlier, the white grouping, white people in Georgia rally, Ku Klux Klan, and their argument is that diversity equals white genocide. And the globe has been trying to push this concept of diversity, which is supposed to be acceptance of other cultures and races and nationalities. But obviously there's a great resistance in North America, particularly in the United States, particularly in the South. So this massive rally shows black people that all white people not into loving black people. And that those who are Negroes must begin to start with themselves and begin to redefine themselves and get black. Because the Negroes seem to be the ones who are causing the problem for the black people. They're the ones who are trying to be close to white people. So there's a whole lot of things going on. And as the Obama administration comes to a close, and black people will no longer have anything to rally about and to cheer about, they're going to put a black woman now on one of the dollar bills. So that is the new scam. They want to introduce Harriet Tubman on the $20 bill. And in my own way, from a distance, it's like, because Obama going out, what else will black people claim that we have? No, well, now they're going to be on the money. But all the other presidents on the money are slave owners, you know. All the other presidents on the American money are owners of slaves. We don't know what the message is. We don't know who is it that makes the decisions in America. Why they don't put Rosa Parks on the money? Rosa Parks must be too recent and too rebellious. They're drawing for Harriet Tubman, who encouraged Africans to escape the plantation and go to Canada. I don't know if that is a new message, that black people must now run away from America now and go to Canada. I think Africa would be better than even Canada. But so it is. And so America will debate this money issue while Trump and Hillary struggle it out. And anyone who win is no kudos for black people. It's a greater problem if Hillary win, because the lesbian and the gays and them people are going to turn loose. And we here in Jamaica, we're going like we can't survive without tourism. We're going to have to eventually bow to these people. But I and I, Rastafari, said no. We now bow to them people. Like. And so that battle will continue with no end at all. As long as Rastaman there, Jamaica, we will not find any space for that agenda. So the struggle continues.
Bought or sold. If you are living in
When we look at locally, what's happening here locally, the most significant thing I will speak of in this short moment is there was a secret swearing in the house of the king, the king's house in Jamaica. And this is, I find, very, very intriguing. Now, the position of the government is that they are leading, they have a one-seat advantage over the opposition. One seat. And from what I hear on the ground, is that they were being threatened by one of the members that he would cross the floor. And if he crossed the floor, we know that the government mash up and everything off will start again. Well, I get to understand that because of this threat, this particular member of the ruling party was secretly sworn in by the Governor General. So secret was the swearing in that the Minister of Information was unaware. What was the purpose of this swearing in now? It was to really calm down the warring minister that they call Warmington. And Warmington, I understand, threatened to cross the floor unless he'd been given an important post. And so he was secretly sworn in. What I really want to reflect on now is the fact that we really have two governments in the country. Not two parties, you know, two governments. One is colonial and one is constitutional. And apparently the colonial government is the bigger and the more powerful of the two governments in Jamaica. The colonial government is the government of the Queen, the Governor General, the Custosses, and the JPs. This is one government unto themselves. The constitutional government is what the people run around and vote for. But there's a link between the Prime Minister and the Governor General that they can carry out some secret activities that nobody else know. I'm really concerned about this political awareness that is in this country, because the Governor General apparently are him run things, but we don't vote for him. So until we begin to challenge that authority, there is no liberation for the people, because we are still under the skirt of Her Majesty. A liberated people must be able to stand on their own. So until we get to that point, or unless we want to get to that point, we have to focus some of our attention now on the Governor General and the King's House and how to reduce those powers, how to eliminate that office ultimately, and how some of those resources can be channeled back into the society. Teachers and doctors, nurses, firemen, civil service can get some of that money out of the King's House. Neville Livingston O'Reilly, the man called Jabi Bunny Wheeler. Yeah, man, still carrying the torch of Rastafari strong in the music. All who say them in a dance hall must recognize the importance of a Rastafari in the music. And in that presence, it's about culture and messages of liberation and upliftment. Now spend the time at all about who a friend and who a friend of me and who bad mind, who no want nobody progress and who never watch on them back. We have to push positive lyrics, uplifting thoughts that can bring the race consciousness forward. Of course, heal up the people, I mean. Buff B. Yes, Norman Lane Corners and down in them corners, down in them places there. Heal up to my long-time listener, Pauline, in St. Mary. And powers and good health to the twins. Heal up to Virgin over in Brother Mark over in Spanish Town. Ras Osa Osa Border in the same region. Either Ras Makonnen, right here in the region of Portland. People in St. Thomas. Yeah, greetings and hail. Yes, Sewell. No, so the people in Hampton Court listen to Styles FM. And we go right across, down into even the community of Harbor View. I would say, hail up Peter Ray. And all the people at the UWI who listen to Metamorphosis and aware of I, man, lock.
Confusion, where I go, the whole world is suffering from illusions, but redemption stands within the scheme of things. The Redeemer's call, the King of Kings, you revive.
The passing through Metamorphosis, and we just got a phone call from Ishmael Rose I'm calling Buddy from Heart Hill. And he was suggesting to me that we need to find ways to improve our governance, because them hide and seek swearing in and man I get pay off for not do all them things that can't be constructive for the upliftment of a nation, you know. So we want to expose the thing them and we'll find better ways of governing. That's not governance, you know, that is trickery. Yeah, that's a form of trickery. People them don't even know what's happening, not even the information minister know. So what kind of thing that we are going with for government? And the government knew, you know. So we say watch it, because we are watching now. Metamorphosis. I am your host. I'm Dr. Iman Block. I've been steering the proceedings, hoping that ones and ones who have been listening have been internalizing some of the information, been digesting some of the information, and have been assimilating some of the information into your own being. Because it's like food has to be digested. And then over time, it becomes part of your makeup, your cellular makeup. So I hope that over all of this time of putting forward reasonings and encouraging people to think, that the process will continue, irrespective of what you don't hear or what you might hear. Yeah, the whole heap of things, man been here. And like a lot of artists, they can get to a point where them feel burnt. Hey. So recovery is vital. So yeah, say that to say that. Metamorphosis is alive. Of Icon Davis out there in living Virginia, and I'm going on to our Earth Day later on. I think it's 3-0. So yeah man, let's give thanks for the eye endurance and hope the eye have another 30 to see for the eye itself what's happening in this world. Yeah man, congratulations on surviving and hope that there'll be many, many more. Seeing? All right.
When obstacles are in my way, you remove them for me, I see. And that's why I'm gonna testify. Watch out. Done for I, sing it out loud and I
Be at the right place at the right time. Move constructive, black people. Males and females, let us end the gender war. Begin to realize that we have been set against each other. That women really and truly are the foundation of I and I society. And we are going to elevate them and encourage them to hold them position, that black supremacy can reign again. It's only black supremacy that will overpower white domination. And black supremacy cannot come into existence unless a woman rises to the level that she knows. I want to heal all the ones again and give thanks for the time at Size FM and the Metamorphosis in its movement. Of course, Metamorphosis suggests and means transformation, and even the metamorphosis itself can undergo a metamorphosis. So until then, peace unto the ones and ones who are listening. Hope that there's prosperity in your homes, prosperity in the family life, prosperity in the job and your school, prosperity in your pocket. Because that is what we need, money, to keep the things flowing. Coach Mark is next with Power in Half an Hour to tell you all about money. I'm on black, I'm on the brown, I'm on the white, I'm on nasty, no Babylon stripe. One love, black man out.
We are going, we are going, we are going.